This was the guy I think they wanted, but he was, he wasn't available, so they cast around and got me, and I'm proud to be here. And I'm sorry I came in late, but, you know, Atlanta Airport delays, machinery problems, you know, the whole thing. Anyway, I'm here, and I could not be happier. I am very grateful to you, Dr. Todd Witcher, and to everyone here. I see people that I think of as the tribe to which I belong, fellow naturalists, systematists, conservationists, friends, friends, old friends, like Dr. Costa there, and many others, and new ones I would like to make. It is an honor to be at the DLI event, and I regret that I hadn't really made much to contribute to it, because I've been running around a lot in different other dark parts of the world, in other parks. But it is certainly one of the amazing forward thrust that has been achieved, both with reference to the national park system and also in science generally, and increasingly in public consciousness. I hope that it will be the model that many others will soon follow. I know some of my good friends in the National Parks Service, a couple of whom are sitting here with me today, Dr. and Mrs. Plum, will share that vision, and I think we may be on our way to make the national park systems centers for, in this country, centers for research and for education. It is a natural role that they should play, and the need for that role in such an iconic part of America, the national park system, has a natural ring to it. And at last, at long last, we are going to include in wildlife tardigrades, lithobiid centipedes, orobatid mites, linifeid spiders, geometric moths, and of course ants, and great roster of 60,000 to 80,000 estimated species that live in this park. I am eager to help spread the gospel generated here in this project to other parks. I'm spending on more and more of my time, and as much time as I have left, to visit and promote national parks around the world and to make comparisons. I've just finished a book, which I hope will be out within a year or so, on the Gorongosa Park of Mozambique, where I've been working. And it would be wonderful to be able to compare what I've found in different countries and different degrees of park development, and what they can do and what they should be doing with the national park system. My first visit to the Great Smoky Mountains National Park was the fall of 1950. I entered the University of Tennessee as a graduate student and came in my first year. I was 21 years old. I promptly got as a teaching assistant, permission from the instructor to give a talk at the general biology class that fall on the amazing new discoveries of the Australopithecine fossils of South Africa, showing that humans did descend from apes, and that we had the missing link and all of that. You know, 21 years old. I wasn't, you know, getting drunk and breaking windows or soaping the dean's car or anything like that. And I waited, you know, because I knew I was breaking the law. I thought I would stir up a little something to talk about. And the students filed out of the class. There were about 100 or 150 of them. They all filed out, not saying anything, until finally one came up to me, a young man. He was kind of timid. And he said, he asked me, and I said, "Here it comes. Here it comes." He said, "Is this going to be on the examination?" So, from those of you who live in states that, how shall we say, are a bit reluctant to plunge their students into evolutionary biology, it might not be as bad as it may seem. Well, in any case, now, globally, from what I've seen, you have seen, let me express, I think, what we share is our view of the relation of life, and the nutshell as follows. Right so far as we proceed, scientists have found the biosphere, that razor-thin membrane is plastered on the surface of the Earth, to be richer in biodiversity than ever before imagined, or certainly not before the last couple of decades. You have demonstrated that so extraordinarily well in the Great Smokies Mountains National Park. What is it, 900 plus new species?
922.
That's amazing, 922 new species. Well, that's an inspiration. Well, biodiversity, which took about 3.5 billion years to evolve, we all know, is being eroded at an accelerating rate by human activity. The loss is going to inflict a heavy price for future generations in wealth, security, spirit. And altogether, the 21st century is destined, in my opinion, although you may not believe it quite yet or willing to agree with me, to be the century of the environment. Immediate future is viewed, can be viewed as a kind of bottleneck we're going through of rapid population growth and high per capita consumption. Science and technology combined with a lack of self-understanding and Paleolithic obstinacy that led to our ruinous practices have brought us to where we are today. And now science and technology, well illustrated by the DLIA, combined with foresight and moral courage, both based on a more enlightened world and moral courage, will have to see us be consulted and used to bring us through that bottleneck and out the other end. Because I think that by the 22nd century, if we do the right thing, we can turn Earth into a sustainable, and I'll dare say it, a very, you know, a reservoir for all of life on Earth and a paradise for our species. You know, there is a redeeming feature in human behavior that was unintended or not, certainly not planned, that takes some of the pressure off, and that's the projection by the United Nations and other population sources, study sources, that due to the plummeting birth rate and the fertility rate in particular of women around the world, we will hit perhaps 10 billion people by the end of the century, maybe sooner, and then it should peak and come down. And what's that responsible, or what made that possible? Well, women's liberation. And I'm not just your ordinary left-wing Harvard professor when I say that this is women's liberation taking charge of their own lives, then resulted in their opting out from lotteries dictated by men, kind of a childbirth lottery dictated by men, and the decision to have smaller families of quality children raised in a quality manner. So all of that sort of came together as an unexpected blessing and of the kind we hope will become more common as education spreads. Now, I'm going to hope I can move the slides forward. Are you going to do that for me, sir? I'm very grateful for you to do that. We'll get past Darwin and the next slide, which I often put the his contributions. Next slide. And the next one, going on, here we are, to something you're all familiar with. I'm going to put it up there anyway. The definition of biodiversity, short for biological diversity, and that is defined as the totality of heritable variation in life on the planet. It can be global. It can be a national park like this one. It can be your backyard, whatever unit you know you're looking at in the ecosystem. And as in this Australian diagram, reminds us that we are studying biological diversity at three levels of organization, biological organization. And they start at the top, as indicated in this diagram, of ecosystems. Ones shown here include rainforests and grassland and mangrove and so on. And then the next level down are the organisms, which are illustrated here mostly for larger ones, not including microorganisms. Well, there are some down at the bottom. Then the next level down are the genes, the diversity of genes that prescribe the traits of the species that compose the ecosystem. Next slide, Professor. Reminds us just how immense biodiversity is. In this diagram, it's way out of date. I did it 20 years ago, but made the compilation 20 years ago. But at least the proportionality of the species in major groups remains about the same. At that time, I estimated that there were about 1.4 million species. The number is now up to, according to my source, which is the survey sponsored by the Australian government and released in 2009, 1.9 million species of organisms are known. How many are there really in the world? I think you've provided the lesson here at DLIA, far more than we had thought. And I should mention, too, that, let me give you the species scape. Next slide. Yeah, okay. This is a way of remembering it, maybe a little more memorable, that this is a world of, I'm not being, you know, partisan when I say that in this diagram, which shows the number of known species as being represented proportionally by the size of a representative organism in it. Thus, the approximately 1 million species of insects known worldwide looms above a tiny elephant representing the 5,000 mammal species known. Beneath the these giant mushrooms, which represent the 100,000 species of fungi known worldwide, and so on. Well, next slide, please. Yes. Now let's look at some of these other creatures that you have been pioneering and studying here. I don't know how much attention you have given to nematodes. Yes, you have nematodes, don't you? How many species of nematodes are there in, known to date in the park?
27,000.
Come on.
Only in the park?
Yes. I know, 47,000 is worldwide. 23 what?
23
nematodes. Oh, you can do better than that. Here I am. I mean, you're going to do better than that. Yeah, you're right. It's roughly 47,000, you say, known species around the world. And I was just, you just blew away my big point when I found out how many thousand are now known from, you know, from the park. I was going to tell you how many are known from the dry valleys of Australia, of Antarctica. You know, it's about three or four. Yeah, that's right. But anyway, the point is, anyway, is that nematodes. Maybe 25,000, no, it was 50,000, 47,000 species known worldwide. But it easily could be, and stop me cold if I got this wrong, it could be, this is what the Australians estimate, 500,000 worldwide.
Well, you're saying 5 million.
Okay, I'll buy that. And the reason I'll buy it is that there are not nearly enough nematologists, and they're not easy to study, but there is they are the most abundant animals in the world, are they not? And someone has estimated 4 out of 5 animals in the world are nematodes, and it's been said that if you were to remove all solid matter off the face of the earth, and leave only, you know, except for geologic and inanimate matter. Inanimate matter too, you know, off the surface. You would have left, and you were left only nematodes. You would see a ghostly outline of a large part of it. Okay, that's it. Well, nonetheless, we know so little about these nematodes. They obviously have an enormous impact or importance for the life or the environment that has scarcely begun to be investigated or even thought about. Let's take fungi. We have, I think, about 100,000 species known worldwide. I'm sort of tiptoeing through this because I've got, as I know, an expert or two in the here that's going to say, going to be wagging his head, you know. 100,000 number of species of nematodes. No, I mean of fungi. The actual estimate, I think, of experts has been holding pretty consistently at least 1.5 million. And when we come, next slide, please, to the microorganisms and the bacteria and the archaea, now we're in the dark matter of biodiversity. It's one thing I don't know about DLIA. Are you doing microorganism studies? I mean, what about prokaryote also? Good. You can really take the lead on that because it's so little has been done. And it's only recently that we've developed DNA sequencing that's cheap enough and fast enough to do biodiversity surveys in prokaryotes, so
even
that's
viruses. Even viruses.
Also viruses, yeah. Well, the figure I have for the number of bacteria species known, if we can ever work out, leave it for the time being, that we haven't really worked out a very good species criterion for bacteria, but you know, we will. People say to me all the time when I bring these subjects up, they say, well, you know, what about the bacteria? You can't count species, and the species concept doesn't work there, and so you can't do that, can you? You don't have anything, a definition of species to go by to even start measuring biodiversity. And my answer to that is, we're going to measure biodiversity, and in the course of which we're going to work out these biological species concept for bacteria. What's the problem? Well, anyway, however we define them, I think there are about 10,000 known species of bacteria there are at the present time. Now, it may have jumped well beyond that because of the DNA sequencing revolution. But anyway, 10,000. We estimate that there are about 1 billion bacteria alone in a gram of soil. That's just the amount of soil you can hold in your hand. And in that gram of soil are represented some 5,000 to 6,000 species of bacteria, say if you have good garden soil. In a ton of soil, it's been estimated live 3 million species of bacteria. We haven't the faintest idea what most of these are. We have, because it's related to medicine, people have, researchers have been studying for the first time the bacteria, the symbiotic, mutualistic, probably, bacteria we have in our mouth and the esophagus. And the number of species living there is already, we know the ones living there, is already past 500. These are our partners among the bacteria living, and probably the ones that can hold off the pathogenic bacteria. So be careful with your mouthwash, will you? and of course, you undoubtedly all know that we have about 1 trillion cells that make up the human body. But we have probably an almost entirely symbiotic relationship, 1 trillion cells. And we have 10 times that many, 10 trillion bacterial cells living with us. So that, you know, if we were good taxonomists and you did it by the preponderance of the cell constitution, humans would be prokaryotes. But my point here is that we have scarcely scratched this fundamental part of biodiversity, and we need to get let it be known that we have not explored this planet. This is a little-known planet, and this should be one of the primary object or goals of biology in the century, is to complete the exploration of this planet. We need thousands of DLIAs going all around the world, and let's promote that. In viruses, next slide, please. Of course, I'm glad to hear you're already working on the viruses. And of course, everyone will be aware, I'm sure you are, that viruses, the vast majority of viruses, are probably important natural elements in the environment. There may be promoters of and controllers of bacterial growth. They're not just on this earth to make people sick. And the number of virus species, no one can even think about in terms of what it is. One estimate has it that the number of virus genes on the planet are probably more of them than there are genes of all other organisms. Next slide. Let's move on past this arcane subject to the next slide. Yes, because I wanted to get swiftly to the genetic diversity. This is a full genetic map of a very small virus, and there's about 1,000 base pairs, nucleotides here. Next slide is a section of the human genome, and this actually shows the DNA of a human cell. And if you were to show all of the DNA of a human cell, all several billion pairs, you would have to have 4,500 of these. Let me give you an even more dramatic example of what a typical genome, you know, mammalian genome, animal genome, the size of it. And here's the way to envision it. Take out all of the DNA from one cell in your body. Put the elements in on end. Don't try to unwind the helix, but unwind the secondary, tertiary, quaternary coils and put a mendone in, and you would have a real, in real space, molecule of about 1 meter long. But you wouldn't see it because it would be as it is, as our DNA is, only about 10 billionths of a meter across. If you were to magically increase that molecule, if you could do it, until you could see it, let's say the width of a piece of wrapping string, then how long would that DNA be? For example, would it go out of this room? Would it go all the way through Gatlinburg, shall we say? Where? How long would it be? It would be 1,820 miles, the distance between New York and Dallas. And as you walked along this, you could count approximately 100 nucleotide base letters per inch. That's what we throw away, in a sense, when we allow species to go extinct. And that's what we're dealing with when we try to get some side of our minds somewhat around what we are studying in studying biological diversity. Where is biodiversity located? Everywhere there is liquid water, or the potential of liquid water, pole to pole from the summit of Mount Everest to the Challenger Deep, 36,000 feet, where we just recently learned teeming with foraminiferous. What are hundreds of species of foraminiferous doing in the Challenger Deep? Well, you haven't even begun to answer all the questions about the Smoky Mountains National Park, so don't worry about that. Somebody else will. And there are other, there are bacteria, there are probably archaea in abundance. We know fish are down there, and so on. And then there are, in the harshest places in the world, sea ice. Bacteria that live in the sea ice, and a remarkable variety of life on the dry McMurdo Valley, which is the closest place on Earth to the surface of Mars in terms of the harshness of its environment. There's plenty of life. You have to get down and chip rocks away and sift, you know, for nematodes. Nematodes, incidentally, are the top of the food chain, Antarctica, but they are there to be studied. and then, if anyone ever gets bored studying biodiversity of Earth, which I doubt seriously will ever happen, although I know a few molecular biologists who get bored hearing about it, you know, they know one nematode, E. coli, and they know one bacterium, and so on. But if you get bored, anybody ever gets bored doing it, I call to your attention the slimes. That's the, I'm not talking about, slime molds or snails. I'm talking about, it's an acronym for the, subterranean lithoautotrophic microbial ecosystems. If you start a few feet below the surface of the Earth, we now know, and you go down as much as 2 kilometers, you will encounter a huge mass of life. So far as we know, it's all bacterial and archaean, and maybe microscopic fungi, but we don't know because we've only begun to explore it. It is autotrophic. It's living off of inorganic materials for energy. It is litho-autotrophic. It's getting those materials from rocks, so it has an unending supply of food. And it forms its own ecosystems going down there, which we've never studied. Has not been studied to any extent. In case you run out of species to find in this park, I recommend boring. and getting into the slime, going on down a few kilometers. Well, just to show you that there's so little we know about this planet. And that, of course, their existence under the ground, in that matter, ancient, no doubt, is one of the things that gives us hope that we will find organisms under the surface of Mars, in the ocean of Europa, and in the hot springs of Enceladus, the moon of Saturn. Next slide, please. Well, I have to mention the tropical rainforest, because that's where most people, most specialists think most of the animal and plant species are found, and that's probably true. And I think it covers about, at the present time, 8% of the land surface, about the equivalent of Florida or a little less, in comparison with the totality of the area of the United States. And it is also under the greatest threat because of continuing indiscriminate clearing for timber and for the creating the planting of money crops. I've just come back from Vanuatu, you know, old New Hebrides, where 57 years ago I saw the island of Santo, the big island in the north, covered with tropical rainforest. Now the entire east of the island has been stripped, mostly by outside corporate interest, the timber taken, and the fertile or volcanic soil used now for growing coconut palm, for copra, and raising cattle, which is about the most unproductive use of a ruined environment like that one can imagine. That's just one of so many truly terrible things that are happening in the tropical rainforest around the world. Next slide. And we've just begun to restore. If you think the Smoky Mountains are, when you hit them for the first time, you think they were unexplored, and they were to a large extent. You should go to take a look, if you have not already, to tropical rainforest faunas and floras. And what's exciting about them is the adventures they are awaiting us, literal physical adventures, especially getting into the canopy. And athletic young biologists are finding ways of getting up there. In the early days of exploring, one of the ways they got up was used by one of our graduate students at Harvard, shoot an arrow over a branch. You may have to fire one up as much as 80 feet over one of those branches, get a lead line, rope it, and climb it, as he's doing there, using rope climbing techniques. And then when you get up there, frequently you will be running into epiphytic gardens like the one on the upper left-hand corner, which are in many forests, rainforests, thick with spiny plants, orchids, gesneriads, and many other species that are, in addition, form thick vines, swarming with stinging wasps and ants. And I'm reminded that Tarzan would not have lasted 15 minutes. But it's a gland of adventure for young scientists. And if I were starting over, no, if I started over, I'd go with microorganisms. But this is better. I mean, this is equally good. Now, you might think that looks dangerous. And I guess it is, but that's what graduate students are for. I'm just kidding, because the first time I ever hear of any serious accident, I'll not use that again. Well, in any case, next slide shows you what we are, what it's like. Well, there's a young woman making her way out, literally where no person has been before. And just imagine getting into a section of a little-known rainforest that no one has ever studied before, with species of plants and animals no one has ever seen when you get into this environment. Next slide shows us how we're getting around. Oh, I know, I've got to mention ants at some point. From that tree, I identified, after I got the fogging material from the National Museum of Natural History, I got the ants, and I found 42 species living in that one tree. And what makes that interesting is that that's about the number of ants, species found in all of the British Isles. Now, I keep looking at the salamander. I don't remember ever seeing one like that. But when I came up in 1950, we joyously did look at the variety of salamanders, including there is a Plethodon jordani, is there not? Oh, yeah, with the red patches. Lifted a rock. There was no regulation of people like us, you know, coming in to collect or anything else. And we didn't take any salamanders. We knew better. But I remember turning a rock and rocks and finding Plethodon jordani. Incidentally, just to keep you awake a little bit longer, when we came here in the October of 1950, we found and went up the slope of a rise above this narrow road that went through the park. There was almost nobody here when we came. And to see the campground, there was a little campground, you know, with burned out fires and so on, that local people, you know, lived back in the hills where they came, they camped, and their purpose was to sit there and watch the cars go by. Anyway, next slide, please. This is the way we're doing it now. Construction cranes and gondolas that can be moved around in every, all around a great circle, lifted up and down through the foliage to different heights, and run back and forth along the arms of the crane to cover an immense amount of space in relative comfort. And this now is the gold standard, the way I think it'll be done all the time now. The next slide shows the gondola. No, that's the prototype one in Panama. Next slide, yeah, the gondola. And if you haven't been in one of those, next slide, I recommend it strongly. No, it seriously, it's like being in heaven. That's what I think those of us who work and dream of biodiversity will be given. We make it to heaven, is that we'll be able to float through the forest around an endless archipelago of rainforest and simply float down, as we did literally, to any part of any tree to get in close to a group of approaching howler monkeys who were unaware of that we were anything threatening, and so on. Next slide, please. And which I want to remind you, well, I don't need to remind this group really, that you have an endless unfolding drama of biodiversity in even very small portions of the temperate forest. We think of the forest, most people think of it as sort of two-dimensional. And we walk on it over like Godzilla crunching down New York. But in the next slide, as you see, you'll see something you are all familiar with, which is even a shallow transect of the soil through the leaf litter into the humus and on down into soil itself gives us the three-dimensional world, the true three-dimensional world, and the, through the descent of which, passing centimeter by centimeter, we traverse different zones of light and of chemistry and of nutrients and of spaces for organisms to fit in. And in each of those layers, this is an example from Central Park, and in each of these layers we find species specialized for just those zones. So in the next slide, next slide please, after that. Yes, is a favorite image of mine. To remind us that something as humble as a rotting tree stump, which would be scarcely noticed by a person walking by and only passing interest to a bird or a mammal, is a continent to a vast array of species of smaller creatures. That as a stump slowly decays over a period of decades, it's providing innumerable micro ecosystems on its surface and under the bark and down deeper into the wood. It's constantly changing because of the evolution of the stump environment itself, and the living species in it are moving, are changing one to the other. You could spend, as I like to say, this is just shows the location. This is a German diagram. No, it's not. No, this is from soil biology monograph. But this just shows the where you find the larvae of these various families of flies in different locations. So that you actually could settle, if you were a biologist, ambitious, wanting to make important discoveries, you could settle at that stump and spend your entire career working on that stump and making one important discovery after another. You could, so in my, the way I like to see it, you could spend your life in a Magellanic voyage around this decaying stump. Well, that's what, and be doing first-class science. That's the great thing about studying biodiversity. Next slide, please. Oh, and this, of course, is to remind you that this is a lifetime call. This is a calling we're in. It is a lifetime commitment. And even if you were trying to make a living doing it, and you should be making a very good living, that's something that we've got to fix in the future, that you would have something to absorb your attention and your respect and create awe and a constant sense of discovery as a naturalist. And it's best to get started as a kid. I got started at very young, 9 or 10 years old. And then you discover this great world out there to explore. And that's me, obviously, in a museum, in a vacant lot next to our old house in Mobile, Alabama. And in the next slide shows me 50 years later. you know, if, how can you ever hope to pretend to dignity be stuffy if you're an evolutionary biologist, particularly if you're a naturalist? You've got to get down. I call it the only way we really get ecology done, the way we're going to get it done well, is with, boots on the ground. That means the real people studying real organisms, rooting them out, studying them, knowing what they are, and finding out what the real world is like, the real living world is like. I must move on. So next slide. The destruction that I don't need to tell you about, going almost unabated around the world. Maybe Brazil is letting up a little bit on the Amazon, maybe not. But tropical Asia, for example, is another major stronghold, which is just destroying its magnificent biodiversity at an accelerating rate. Next slide. And burning a lot of it. Those points of light seen from space weather satellites with the clouds taken off show what the Earth actually looks like, say, to an alien ship coming in and sailing around at night. This is the way it would look. And I call your attention to the South American rainforest and then the Congo forest, all the way up to the Sahel, the zone beneath the Saharan desert. Endless points of light. Those are man-made, and they are the burning of trees and vegetation cut away, in some cases grasslands, the rapidly disappearing tropical grassland, just to get a little bit more fertility out of the ash of the dead trees and keep the local doomed slash and burn agriculture going a few more years. Next slide. We all know, do all of us know? Well, that as you cut away any habitat, you fill in a lake, you cut off with dams two of three of the feeder streams of a river system and basin, that you reduce the number of species that can be kept there sustainably, indefinitely. You reduce the number by a very predictable amount. And this is the base that Robert MacArthur and I used many years ago, the beginning of it, to derive principles of conservation biology which stress the importance of area, especially, and presented the beginning of understanding of reasons why area is so important for maintaining biodiversity. Next slide. This is true of real islands and also habitat islands, such as one shown here. Next slide. And now, with that in mind, for example, from the formula, the species area curve formula, you can estimate that if you remove all but 10% of a habitat, then you will reduce the number of species sustainable in the remaining 10% by approximately one half. Now, you still got to have one half, but notice, you've cut 90%. The remaining 10% could go, and you know, with a few timbering crews, or teams with bulldozers, in a matter of weeks for many of these most threatened areas. You remove the last 10%, you remove the last 50% of the species. And this is just one of the many horror stories that, from around the world. The Philippine Islands had one of the most magnificent forest systems in the world, which they had maintained and harvested sustainably and taken care of, they'd have today, and they'd be far better off economically for it. But I'm going to ask you to look at the date, upper right-hand corner, and how much of the forest, how much of the islands was covered by mostly tropical forest in that year. And just look at those two figures and then watch the green as we proceed through the 20th century. Next slide. Going. Now the Philippine government seems ready to start slamming on the brakes, we hope. Next slide shows the same thing that happened in the state of Sao Paulo. From the time Darwin visited, upper corner of the upper diagram was Darwin's time to the present time. It really has been decimated, literally 90% or so, by the growth of population and development. This is the grand forest, distinct in its species composition from the Amazonian forest very special. Darwin himself was so anxious to see it as a very young man arriving on the Beagle that he became desperate when the customs people would not allow him in, just to come in so he could look at the forest. And he noted in his notebook, unpublished notebook, he said, "I would kiss the dust off the feet of those officials if they would let me through and see that forest." Well, he never got to, he did get to see it, sorry. I think he would be desperately disappointed if he were alive today and could see what happened to it. Next slide, please. Now, I'm approaching the end of my little disposition, and I thought that I would show you a few of the endangered and extinct species of the world. It reminds us all that having figures, having time curves, having formulas has an effect, but the real effect comes when you become familiar with individual species and you care about them and you care about what happens to them and you try to save them and you learn more and more about their biology. And when they're gone, that you realize how much was lost because we hadn't even begun to learn what the species was, what its full life cycle was, all its physiology, its genome, place in the ecosystem. We didn't know what happened. So let's look at some of these creatures. This is one of the species of Atelopus. Frogs have been, as you know, large numbers of species have been wiped out by probably as a result of one invasive species of chytrid fungus, but by other causes as well in Central America and the highlands, pushed to extinction by the rise in critical elevational, the lifting up by climate change to higher elevations of the critical habitats and so on. Next slide. We have seen alien species that are causing a lot of this, and the number of alien species is in every country where it's been measured rising exponentially. So the world as a whole, what we're doing is we're actually just spreading species all over the world. Some of them are going to be invasive. Invasive is defined as alien and causing some harm to humans or the environment. So we're getting more and more as time goes on. Next slide. The brown tree snake, originally from the Solomons, apparently got introduced into Guam shortly after the Second World War. It's a specialist on nestling birds. That's what it specialized to feed on. And before people realized what had happened, it had wiped out every single bird, songbird, on Guam. Everyone, every individual. Next slide. And then on to some of the beautiful creatures that we're losing or on the brink of losing, the cerulean paradise flycatcher, thought to be extinct on the Solomon Islands due to deforestation. A very small population has been found on one island in Palawan and in the Palawan Island, the archipelago, and it's hoping that maybe that could be, the species could be saved, held on to. Next slide. The orang is really endangered, the Bornean orang, which is probably a different species from the Sumatran, is down, approaching one half of the original population due to forest clearing. Next slide. The ivory-billed woodpecker. Come on, it's gone. I followed that closely and was disappointed along with everything else when it became apparent that the video of that was taken in the Arkansas floodplain forest is probably a pileated woodpecker. But it was about 3 years ago that a group at Auburn University wrote me and they asked me to sponsor a paper they had written on the discovery of an entire population of ivory pill woodpeckers. As it turned out, in the floodplain forests of the Choctaw Hatchie River, one of these coastal rivers that runs across the panhandle, and these were good scientists, I mean, there's a reputable faculty at Auburn University. They said they had seen a couple, they'd drawn sketches, they'd seen the nest hole, recent nest holes, typical of ivory bills, and they were certain they were there. And would I go ahead and sponsor the paper, I guess proceed to the National Academy or someplace like that, or recommend this publication? Because the level of skepticism was so high, it would take a bit of pressure to get something else published like that. So I did tell them, and they agreed. I said, you know, you've got to have irrefutable proof. You've got to have film clips. Let's get some DNA. Go ahead, you know, and the world will embrace you if you could show there's an actual population still alive. They said, well, it's summer now. It's hard to get in and get that information. We'll get it in the winter when the forest is clear, more open from deciduous trees shedding. And the winter went by, and I didn't hear anything. The summer came, and another went by, and I didn't hear anything. So I decided pretty much that, well, it was a mistake, maybe, but maybe not. Because I was in with a group of naturalists near Fort Walton Beach just a little more than a year ago. And we were sitting around out in the woods at a settlement where work is going on, research and teaching. And one of the naturalists there, I've forgotten his name, said, well, yeah, probably not, it's not there. We can't hold. I'd gone up to Choctaw Hatchie myself. But you know, you don't go up and spot something like that just on a little day's journey. Anyway, he said, I want you to listen to this. So he said, this was given to me by the Auburn group. And so he played it. And we heard beep, 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 beep. And the bird expert would have said, that's an ivory bill. So maybe next slide, please. This is the Imperial. That's another maybe, even bigger than the Ivoryville. Believed to be extinguished in 1960. It's thought that the last specimen was killed and eaten by a truck driver. No, seriously, took it home and he shared the meat with his mother, and when he was asked about it, he said, yes, this is a fine piece of meat. But don't give up hope, because the Sierra Madre Occidental is a very rugged country with a right habitat for the Imperial. And you don't go back in there right now with the conditions in Mexico, and maybe, just maybe. Next slide, please. The golden toad of Costa Rica. It was abundant in the mountains of the central Cordillera. It was practically the national animal of Costa Rica. They were very proud of this beautiful little frog. And then, for reasons we don't know, 1 year, gone, extinct. Next slide. Yeah. The striped tree snails of the Pacific archipelagos, they really are an ornament in the forest when they are there. Extinct in French Oceania, Polynesia, French Polynesia. Half the species are gone in Hawaii, and the other half are endangered. Next slide. The endangered plants of Hawaii. Hawaii is the extinction capital of the world, of the United States anyway, one of the major extinction centers of the world. Well, next slide. But that's one of the species that survived. When the first Hawaiian voyagers first put ashore in Hawaii, we now know from paleontological studies that upwards of 150 species of birds were there and endemic to Hawaii, including an eagle, flightless ibis, giant goose-like birds, flightless. And so by the time the Europeans came along, most of those were gone. And then the European and Asian colonists brought the number down to a pitiful 25, most of which are honey creepers, some of those are extinct, some living, but barely hanging on in the mountain forest of Hawaii. Next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah. These are the hot spots, some of the hot spots in the world, where maybe I think the southern Appalachians would qualify as such a hot spot in the United States, where large numbers of species are located, which are limited. It would be true of fish, amphibians, and a few other things, for example, just in the Smoky Mountains, where their ranges are limited to that, or just a small area around, which if removed or destroyed would take with it a lot of species. And these hot spots, as they're called then, have been mapped, and a great deal more research done on them since I put together that slide. I mean, I got it from Norman Myers' article. The Conservation International, about 10 years ago, while I was a member of the board, held a special conference and a study to figure out what it would cost to cover those 34 hotspots on the land. Of course, there are hotspots in coastal and shallow marine areas and deltaic areas and so on, too. But this is the terrestrial. How much would it cost if we covered those enough to protect the species, including helping economic development of the people in and around these areas, so that we could turn them into protectors, you know, instead of being forced to use those resources that include the endangered species. And the estimate came up as follows. If you cover those 34 areas, you'd have to do it, you know, with pinpoint accuracy in substantial areas. The cost would be approximately 0.1% and it would be one payment would do it, 0.1%, one part in a thousand of the combined gross domestic products of all the countries in the world. That's the gross world product. And that's for 1 year, one part in a thousand. And you would save a half or more of the species on Earth that we know of, at least terrestrial. So I've been asking, and others have been asking all along, can humanity afford one part in a thousand, which could be paid out to over a period of time, of our gross world product, one part in a thousand, to save the rest of life or a large part of it? That's a question that has never been satisfactorily answered. And we've had very few people stepping of any political consequence, stepping forward and picking up on that and making something of it own, of it. Now I have to draw to a close, and I will do it by telling you how I see the big picture here. And that is that we're in a situation now where the central problem in terms of the environment, the living environment, and that's the one that counts, in my opinion, is how to raise the poor to an endurable quality of life while preserving as much of the natural world as possible. What is the connection between those two? Both the poor and the biological diversity are concentrated in developing countries. And the solution for the problem has to flow and the recognition that both depend on the other. The poor, especially the more than 1 billion who are classified by the United Nations as absolutely destitute, have little chance to improve their lives in a devastated environment. And conversely, the natural environment where most of biodiversity hangs on cannot survive the press of land-hungry people who have nowhere else to go. So I hope that in this brief time, I've been privileged to join you, my friends, my colleagues, the problem, that we can feel, we can believe that the problem can be solved. The resources to do it exist. Those who control those resources have many reasons to achieve that goal, and for their own security, long-term security. The cost is not high. The benefits are beyond calculation. At the end of the day, however, the direction we take will be an ethical decision. It will have to have a religious intensity, not as a consequence of religious belief, but that kind of intensity and commitment. A civilization that's able to envision God in an afterlife and embark on the colonization of space, envision it anyway, is surely going to find a way to save the integrity of this magnificent planet and the life it harbors, because simply it's the right thing to do. I like to quote John Sawhill, a friend of mine, who was president of the Nature Conservancy and died in accident prematurely. He said, a society is defined not only by what it creates, but by what it refuses to destroy. Now I have just finished book I've written on Gorongosa Park in Mozambique, but it could be, you know, any park, because I would like to apply this perception, which I share with I know others, including my friend Lynn Plum, who's discussed this with me at some length, about why parks are so important to humanity. And I'm not speaking just as a source of new drugs and not as a source of rehabilitating rest and relaxation. I'm talking about important to us and our deeper meaning as a species. In one important respect, the living world of nature, the world right outside from here, is vastly superior to humanity. The complexity of its layered structure and the billion-year history of its construction lie beyond anything that can be unraveled or copied. A warehouse of parallel zettabyte computers could not simulate it. In comparison, they are paltry. The starting conclusions might be guessed, of that we can never be sure. But the magnitude of the events in all the lives of all the species reverberating back and forth across the levels of biological organization, from macromolecule to ecosystem, to create natural selection through an all but infinite maze of possibilities, is beyond the comprehension of the still mostly paleolithic brain that we possess, put together only in recent geologic time. This is the reality of the world that we have preserved in national parks and other reserves around the world. It is our transcendent heritage, and we will be wise to hold on to it. We can enjoy its surviving fragments in various ways and measures, through surprise, mystery, awe, wholeness, relief, redemption, but deeper still is a sense of the infinite latent in the wildlands. There is a hope for the immortality of life, freed of human cares and intervention, and allowed to evolve as it did before we arose so recently in Africa. While our species continues to manufacture its radically different human world, the rest of life should be allowed to endure forever. for our own safety, while preserving our own deep history. It will, if we choose, continue on its own way as independently as possible, changing in evolutionary time. By maintaining two parallel worlds on the planet, humanity will better ensure the survival and the continued advance of the rest of lives and of ourselves. And that is why I consider you defenders and champions. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to